So going into the treatment of mitral regurgitation, before that, let's understand what mitral regurgitation and how interventionalists or what kind of mitral regurgitation is it that the interventionalist can treat. So you have a normal looking valve, which is right on the left side. Then you have mitral regurgitation, which is a primary, which includes both are called degenerative mitral MR, which is one due to prolapse. The other one is flail, where you see the chordae ruptured. And then is a functional MR, which could be ischemic versus non-ischemic. That is because there what also you see is a LV dilation. So before you think of doing percutaneous mitral valve repair, you need to have what is called as a conducive anatomy where we can repair the valve. And one of them would be an attractive or approachable coronary sinus, which would be here. So you can do something to the coronary sinus, and that will help. No, this does not move here. Which will help to decrease the annulus. The other one would be just a mitral clip where, you know, you clip the leaflet. That could also decrease the mitral regurgitation. And the other one would be reducing the mitral annular dimension, which will also help in decreasing the LV cavity size. So up to 2016, with regards to repair and replacement, there have been so many devices out there. And two of them, which I'm going to show you during my talk here. The most important trial which actually led to the approval of a percutaneous mitral clip was Everest II, which was a randomized clinical trial where they randomized patients who had mitral regurgitation who were suitable both for percutaneous treatment as well as surgical treatment to mitral valve surgery, or which is repair versus replacement versus catheter-based treatment. And this is just a animation showing how the mitral clip works. If you see here, this is what we have to do. We have to go through the transeptal and just get the guide inserted through the transeptal into the left atrium. Then you have your mitral clip, which we are able to position it. They're just trying to show that you can go lateral, medial, anterior, posterior. You will open the clip, then get into the LV. It's very important that you align it well so you're getting the right part of the mitral valve. Once you think you're there, this entire procedure is done with echo guidance, and on the echo you will use a color Doppler and see if how the mitral regurgitation is. If there is no change in mitral regurgitation and you're not happy, you can release the clip, grasp it again, and when you think you're happy, you will leave the clip there and the catheter will come out. That's what the eval mitral clip is. And this is just an example here. This is a left ventriculogram showing 4+ mitral regurgitation. You see a lot of dye going into the left atrium. This is an echocardiogram showing severe mitral regurgitation. And now you can see the clip with mitral MR just about 1+, just around 1+. And the echo, probably you're seeing between 1 to 2+ of mitral regurgitation. And this is what we see in the clinical practice as well as what the trial have shown, that when you have done the mitral clip, when you have mitral regurgitation where we quantify severe as 3 to 4+, that you reduce it between 1 to 2+. And this was a study design, about 279 patients enrolled over 39 sites, and a significant MR, which we call as 3 or 4+, and had to have anatomy that will be suitable for a percutaneous clip. They were randomized 2-to-1. The device group, which was a mitral clip group, 180 patient, 84 patient, and the control, which was surgical repair or replacement. And they had a follow-up, which included echocardiography as well as clinical follow-up, baseline, 30 days, 6 months, 1 year, up to 5 years. And this was the primary endpoint per protocol. The first thing was safety of the device. If you see at 30 days that it was very safe, that device we were able to do the, they were able to do the device safely. And the second one was at 12 months, clinical success rate. And what was clinical success rate? That outcome of death, need for repeat mitral valve surgery, reoperation, or presence of mitral regurgitation greater than 2+ at 12 months. And that if you see control group versus the device group, which was non-inferiority, that it was comparable. Based on that trial, which was published actually in the New England Journal, the conclusion was that although percutaneous repair was less effective in reducing mitral regurgitation, when they said means a baseline 1 to 2+ was there in the CLIP group, then the conventional surgery procedure was associated with superior safety, which we showed, and similar improvement in clinical outcome, which I will show what it was. Based on that, FDA approved the CLIP, especially for degenerative mitral regurgitation. And this is what the important slide where you see the baseline. If you see the echocardiographic MR was about 4+, both in the device as well as in the surgical group. And at 12 months, 3 to 4+ MR, about 18% in the CLIP group, whereas 0% in the surgical group. But if you see, NYHA functional class was no different. Essentially saying, even if in the CLIP group there was 1 to 2+ of MR, when you give medical therapy, functional class was the same. Essentially, they did very well clinically. And this is also a very important slide, which is showing that this is freedom from death, MV surgery or reoperation. Of course, the surgery did better when you take the entire group. But what happened is, at 6 months, if there was residual MR, a percentage of patient about had to reop. Once, after 6 months, if you see, both the surgical group as well as the device group did, their outcome was similar up to 5 years. And this is just a five-year outcome in patient who were alive after 1 year when reoperation has been done. And what you see is that other than 1+ MR, which was significant in the CLIP group, which we know, everything else, mortality and NYHA class was similar between the surgical group versus the CLIP group. There was a high-risk sub-study also of the Everest. And what was high-risk sub-study? It was about 78 patients with 3 to 4+ MR who had very high Syntax score, not Syntax, the STS score. Mean age, if you see, was about 77 years, and NYHA class about 3 to 4. And when we said what is a high risk is because of 50% of them already had had prior cardiac surgery. And what happened was they were CLIP implanted in about 75 patients with acute MR reduction in about 82% of the cases. And if you see this kind of high risk patient, what about the they compared them to the group which only had medical therapy. So compared to medical therapy versus high risk, which was here, and compared to the medical group, which was here, the survival was definitely better. That you are saying at 12 months only on medical therapy, only half of the patients survived. About 25% more patients survived if they had the CLIP. So TMVR is a in patients with prohibitive surgical risk is associated with safety and good clinical outcome, including decrease in rehospitalization, functional improvement, and favorable ventricular modeling at 1 year. These are just the prospective multicenter registries that are ongoing of all the CLIP that has happened. Post-approval, if you take about this patient, this is the registry showing that all pooled studies, high-risk sub-studies, as well as low-risk patients who have got the CLIP, essentially showing that procedural death is very low, it's a safe procedure, and need for repeat CLIP also is also very low in these patients. Very important also, I think one thing that we need to pay attention is the TIA or stroke is also very low in this group of patients, saying that this procedure is safe. What is the worldwide experience using the CLIP right now, taking into account all the registries and the randomized trial and commercial use? More than 20,000 patients worldwide have received this device at this time. So acute procedural success rate, if you see here, when it started way back in 2004 to now, the acute success was just about 60% or so, but we are reaching close to 100%, essentially saying that training has made the operators better in using this device. So so far we discussed about the degenerative mitral regurgitation. What about mitral clip for functional mitral regurgitation? There also you see that a pooled study, about 9 studies, which showed that there is a significant improvement even in the functional MR. And where you see improvement is again in a functional class as well as remodeling in patients who have functional MR due to dilated hearts. Now, there is one thing caveat, there is limited in patients who have atrial fibrillation. 2 trials are ongoing to understand if the percutaneous therapy, as well, especially CLIP, is suitable for patients with a functional MR, which is a co-op trial design, about 420 patients in 75 US sites. Same patient with the functional mitral regurgitation, which has to be more than 3+, high risk for mitral valve surgery, and should meet the echocardiographic criteria, and also should be on full medical therapy. That's very important here. Will be randomized 1-to-1, standard group, which is a standard of care versus a mitral clip, and there will be follow-up of this patient. Trial is ongoing. The similar trial which is happening in Europe, which is called as a reshape heart failure, is happening. Now, other approaches are the coronary sinus approach. If you see here, which I showed earlier, is using this device, go around the coronary sinus to cinch the annulus and make the mitral annulus smaller to see the regurgitation will go down. And direct annuloplasty approaches, 3 devices are out there to see same thing around the mitral valve. Other one is a mitral annular reduction, which is also called millipede, which helps in changing, which will be like a ring in the mitral valve to decrease the regurgitation. Just to show you a case of which actually we did here of a percutaneous mitral valve in valve replacement. So far we discussed the CLIP. This is where you can place a valve in a previously placed mitral valve. It's an 80-year-old female who had worsening exertional dyspnea of class 3. And if you see her, she has been already AFib, CAD, and prior multiple PCI, has his pacemaker as well as a bioprosthetic MVR that was done. So she has been on Coumadin and all the medication for her heart failure. So transthoracic echo done had shown that she had mitral valve stenosis with a mean gradient of about 12 millimeters of mercury and EF of 32%, atrial fibrillation. Now, she had an STS score of 9.4%, and she was determined high risk for repeat surgery. So the plan was, could we take care of this mitral stenosis by doing a percutaneous valve via the transseptal approach? And this is a pre-procedure TE, which showed that she had severe bioprosthetic mitral stenosis. This is a 3D echo, again showing the same thing, EF 32% and a gradient of, this is what you see on the echocardiogram here, the mitral stenosis with a gradient of about 12. This is a prosthetic mitral valve, definitely stenosed, and you don't see movement of the leaflets, no mitral regurgitation or mild mitral regurgitation. This is the 3D echo before the valve placement. So the procedure is done under general anesthesia and TE guidance. We need a venous approach for this, and it is what we are using is the Sapien valve, right now approved for aortic valve procedure. will be used or to be placed on the mitral side. So you have to go through the transseptal puncture, and this is the valve. This is the previous surgical valve. Right now, we have gone through the inferior vena cava, through the transseptal, and we have the Edwards Sapien valve sitting inside the previous valve. This is the balloon inflation, which has to be done with rapid pacing. There should be no cardiac output at this time. And this is what you see here. No mitral regurgitation and decrease in the mitral gradient. If you can see, like a mesh here, that is the new valve which was placed inside the previous valve. And the entire procedure was done with the TE guidance. So this is a 3D echo after the valve placement. If you see, you can see a complete opening of the new valve that has been placed. Patient was extubated immediately, had uneventful recovery, and discharged home after 2 days. Now, talking about transcatheter mitral valve replacement, they can be done with two approaches. Right now, all the new devices that are out there, which I'm showing here, would be, most of them will be tried by the apical route, with the transapical route to go to the mitral valve position, and subsequently will be transseptal to be done percutaneously. Most of them are self-expanding. What we are facing right now, two important things where with this valve being placed in the mitral, that one, embolization, two, also thrombosis of this valve. So coming to what the development have been with the transmitral valve replacement in 2016 is that mitral clip result in clinically significant MR reduction in majority of the patient. Clip is safer than surgery with shorter time to recovery, but less effective than surgery in MR reduction. Mitral clip results in similar patient-centered outcome to surgery, including improvement in heart failure class and quality of life, as well as reduction in readmission. Therefore, clip is ideally suited for poor surgical candidates with appropriate anatomy. Clip therapy is now FDA approved for symptomatic patients with severe mitral regurgitation etiology who are poor surgical candidates. For patients with symptomatic functional MR, mitral clip is available through co-opt trial, which is a randomized trial ongoing at this time. Newer devices have potential, but still a long way to go. And TMVR may be the future for patients for a high-risk MR, but technical and thrombotic issues are being encountered in their early stages of implant. Thank you for your attention.